technical support line. Also, if you happen to lose connectivity, please go ahead and log back in. At any point during the webinar, you may type your questions for our presenters in the questions box on your screen, and we'll do our best to answer them after the presentations. Please be sure to identify if the question is for a particular panelist. We'll be live tweeting today's webinar and encourage you to do the same using the hashtag AcceleratedEd, which you see on the screen. Finally, please note that the slides and a recording of today's session will be available on the CCRS Center and AYPF websites. Next slide. For those of you who are new to our webinar series, the College and Career Readiness and Success Center, which is housed at the American Institutes for Research, is part of a network of federally funded comprehensive centers that provide technical assistance and resources to our regional partners and the states they serve on key educational reform issues. The American Youth Policy Forum, our co-host, is a lead partner of our center. As a CCRS technical assistance hub, we collaborate with federal and external centers and resource providers to promote knowledge development, dissemination, and application through technology-based activities such as this webinar today. Next slide. We invite you to visit our website, ccrscenter.org, to access a copy of this webinar and to learn more about other CCRS resources and activities that may be of interest to you and your colleagues. Next slide. Over the past few months, the CCRS Center has been exploring and sharing information and tools around accelerated learning options, starting with a brief release last November. This brief aims to bring some clarity to use of the term acceleration by focusing on research-supported strategies both within and across secondary and post-secondary education that allow students to accelerate their learning and thus build momentum towards long-term success. Next slide. In addition, we have held a three-part webinar series on accelerated learning in collaboration with AYPF, culminating with today's webinar. Previous webinars broadly discussed the use of acceleration in secondary and post-secondary settings to create flexible, personalized learning opportunities for students and considered specific models of practice. Today's webinar focuses on the role of state policy to help build, develop, and sustain high-quality dual enrollment, an acceleration strategy operating across secondary and post-secondary education. To address terminology confusion that often plagues discussions of acceleration, today's webinar will use the term dual enrollment to refer to any opportunity for a high school student to enroll in college courses. By this definition, we include college courses taught at any location, through any delivery modality, by any instructor type, and regardless of whether or not students receive high school credit. Our presenters, when necessary, will identify when they are referring to a specific model under the broader umbrella of our definition. I'm going to briefly introduce today's presenters in the order they will be speaking. Please note that following each presentation, we will have an opportunity for clarifying questions, so we encourage you to type them into the question box throughout the webinar. For questions not addressed during today's webinar, we will do our best to either connect you with the presenter or post responses on the CCRS Center blog Ready for Success. Our first presenter will be Jennifer Dounay Zinth, a senior policy analyst at Education Commission of the States. She will be sharing information from ECS's recently updated database on dual enrollment policy, as well as their recently released brief on model policy components. Jennifer will be followed by Adam Lowe, executive director of the National Alliance of Concurrent Enrollment Partnerships, who will talk about the role his organization has played through accreditation to support quality dual enrollment programs. John Fischer, Deputy Commissioner of the Vermont Agency of Education, and Joyce Judy, President of the Community College of Vermont, will share their state's experiences in supporting and expanding high-quality dual enrollment pathways. They will speak about both the legislative role and the capacity building efforts across secondary and post-secondary institutions. Our question and answer period will be moderated by Jennifer Brown Lerner, of the American Youth Policy Forum, our lead partner and co-host. So let's begin our presentations with Jennifer Dounay Zinth.
Good afternoon. Thanks to everyone who's joining in today. Just a quick word about ECS before I get started. It's a national organization. We're based in Denver, Colorado, and as you can see from the slide, we represent the, across the spectrum of education policymakers in the 50 states, D.C., and the territories, including governors and their staff, state legislators and their staff, state chiefs and board members, as well as postsecondary leaders. So you see here we have there are three main topics that I'd like to cover today. Briefly give an introduction to ECS's recently updated database on dual enrollment. Talk about some of the trends that we identified in updating this database, which was created in 2008 initially. And then also talk briefly about model components of dual enrollment policy, things that we've seen enacted in policy that seem to make a difference for student access and program quality. So a quick word about this database. In December of 2013, we launched an update to our 2008 dual enrollment database, and this was, in fact, a massive undertaking for various reasons. One, I've worked on a number of policy issues at ECS since the 1990s, and I have to say dual enrollment is right up there among the most complicated issues I've dealt with. Many states have more than one program, and policies in some states are vague as to which components are applicable to which programs. Sometimes statutes and regulations in the same state will conflict with one another, or sometimes the statute refers to a program by one name while regulations refer to the same program by a slightly different name, or the Department of Education prefers one name and the higher education entity in the same state prefers to refer to the program by another name. In some instances, statutes or regs are on the books but are not currently active. So as a result of multiple dual enrollment programs in many states and this vague or conflicting policies in some states, I was extremely thorough in conducting this update. I used a whole list of search terms and statutes and regs, comparing against ECS's ongoing policy tracking database to identify if terms may not be picking up everything. I also searched for quote-unquote policy documents by K-12 or higher education boards that were standalone documents not incorporated into regulations. I then reached out to one or more state contacts in each state, and I want to give a shout out to Adam for sharing leads with us in many states, asking them to verify ECS's interpretation of policies in their state or make any changes if needed. And my hope is that we will be able to annually update this resource so we can continue to have a national perspective on dual enrollment policies and identify where changes are being made that are likely to extend program access and quality and help point states to others whose policies they can consider as they seek to improve their programs. So to reach the database, you can go to our homepage, www.ecs.org, and select High School Policy Center from the Programs Institute's drop-down you see on the right side of the screen. This will take you to this landing page, which is primarily resources developed through a substantial Gates contract that ECS had several years ago. You'll see dual enrollment under high school topics in the list on the left-hand side of the page. By clicking dual enrollment, you will go to this landing page for the database. And from this page, if you wanted to see all dual enrollment policies for a single state, you can pull up a map and select your state. So let's pull up Kentucky. This will take you to this page, and you can see here we have the 20 data points for Kentucky. You'll see where we've clarified which policy components apply to which programs if there are more than two dual enrollment programs in a state. And going back to that database landing page we were on a moment ago, you could also select the top link under 50 state reports, and that will allow you to see all data points across all states, or you can select a single data point to view policies on a single topic across the 50 states and DC. So there are four trends I'd like to touch upon today. I could spend the entire webinar talking about everything that we saw that changed from 2008 to 2013, but I'll focus today on these four: notification, quality, reporting, and evaluation. I'm more than happy to take your questions on trends, on what we're seeing on other data points, either during Q&A or if you'd like to contact me directly after this webinar. So going to notification, it's a really obvious one that if you don't no program exists, you can't participate. But anyway, by notification we meant, is there a statewide policy, not just local district or institutional system policy, that requires all students and or their parents, not just students who meet eligibility requirements, to be notified of the availability of dual enrollment programs? So it sounds simple and obvious that, like I said, students can't participate in a program if they don't know it exists. Yet, and this somewhat surprised me since it does seem like such an obvious thing to include in a state's dual enrollment policy, just 20 states have this in policy. These were, in fact, the same 20 states that had this in policy in 2008. It looks like it dropped from 20 to 18 states, but we reconfigured answers for two states to require notification for one program but not another. And just as we did in 2008, we saw a great deal of variability in policies. There were some states that simply said that students and parents needed to be notified, and there were other states that were much more specific on the types of essential program information all students and parents need to receive, hopefully allowing families in those states to make much better informed decisions on whether or not a student should participate. So going on to quality, this is another critical issue. If dual enrollment programs are truly to provide high school students with an authentic college experience, if postsecondary institutions aren't going to get heartburn over awarding credit toward the general core or student's major for successfully completed dual enrollment coursework. And just as with notification policies, we see policies on this issue fall across a wide spectrum. Some states simply say that the local agreement between a school district and a postsecondary institution must provide for program quality. While at the other end of the spectrum, we have some state policies that are extremely explicit, spelling out what K-12 and postsecondary partners must do to ensure the course delivered at a high school looks just like the course if delivered to traditional postsecondary students at the postsecondary campus. And the list on the slide is by no means exhaustive, but it does give a sense of the diversity of approaches states are taking. And some states require multiple boxes to be checked on this list. And the good news is we did see positive growth in state policies regarding course quality from 2008-2013, with 37 of the 47 states with dual enrollment policies on the books, including policies to ensure course quality. And reporting is absolutely necessary if states are to evaluate which students are accessing dual enrollment programs and the success of those students, both in terms of completing dual enrollment courses and in those students entering postsecondary education, placing into credit-bearing coursework, participating to degree in completion, et cetera. So while we did see more states adding policies to require reporting from 18 to 30 states over that five-year period, it does strike me as odd that in an era where states are publicly reporting on so many other indicators of student performance, there were 20 states, or you could say 17 of the states with dual enrollment policies on the books, have no requirement that K-12 or postsecondary partners publicly report any data on dual enrollment participation outcomes. And as with other elements of dual enrollment policy, requirements vary substantially, with some states simply requiring districts or institutions to report the number of students participating in dual enrollment and or the courses being offered for dual enrollment, while other states require student data to be disaggregated by student characteristics or information on who's teaching these courses, such as high school or postsecondary instructors, costs associated with the program, and how former program participants are faring once they enter higher education in the state. And I want to also clarify that this was not necessarily reporting for accountability purposes. ECS did collect this information about states that either require dual enrollment participation to be incorporated into a school or district's accountability grade, or whether the state requires the school or district to include dual enrollment participation on their public report cards. And we can talk more about that at another point. Evaluation is really critical. We're really doing a disservice to everyone in this system, either students, parents, taxpayers, if we're not ensuring that students' enrollment programs are performing well once they finish high school and enter college, and that there aren't significant disparities in program outcomes from institution to institution or from district to district. I was quite frankly amazed when I saw that the number of states with evaluation elements built into their dual enrollment policies doubled from 2008 to 2013, from 13 to 26 states. It's encouraging that policymakers seem to get that evaluation is critical. And just as with other policy elements, state policies are very divergent on their approaches to evaluation. Some leave it entirely for local K-12 and higher education partnerships to sort out. Others are very specific in the data that state-level entities need to evaluate and direct entities to make recommendations for changes to state policy as they see fit. So this past Monday, ECS issued a report that I hope will be tremendously valuable as states seek to improve program quality and access, particularly for low-income and minority students who, as research shows, are in many states underrepresented in dual enrollment programs. This report is currently available from the ECS homepage on the upper left-hand corner under What's New. It's my hope that states will be able to cross-check their policies in the dual enrollment database against the model policy components and see where policy gaps may be providing some unintentional barriers to program participation or quality. There are 13 model policy components. They fall under four umbrellas, you could say. The first umbrella having to do with access. I'll pause for a few seconds to allow you to read these. And as you can see, incorporating these would make sure that state or local policies don't unintentionally shut out from new enrollment participation students who could benefit from participation. And these policies have the potential for students who have the potential to succeed in a college-level course but might otherwise not participate if these policy components were not all in place. Finance, the next two model policy components have to do with how programs are funded. Having both of these components in policy ensures that there are not barriers to program participation either from the student or parent side or from the district or post-secondary institution's perspective. The next four model policy components have to do with what we were talking about earlier, course quality, reporting, evaluation. It's really essential for states to put these policies in place so that dual enrollment courses are truly providing students with exposure to college-level content and that programs are monitored and evaluated to ensure broad student access to programs and ensure that students are experiencing success both during and after program participation. And the last model policy component has to do with transferability of courses. In order to for students and parents not to lose their investment, or states for that matter, so programs aren't really living up to their potential if students end up retaking coursework they've already completed through dual enrollment because the course is only recognized as quote-unquote elective credits by the post-secondary institution they end up enrolling in. And there are state data that show that incorporating these 13 components into policy has the potential to make a tremendous difference. And I'm just about out of time, but I'm happy to talk more about this alignment between these components and what we've seen in states such as Colorado. You can do so either during the Q&A or offline. So my final slide today provides a quick overview of what you can expect to see from ECS on this issue of dual enrollment in the coming months, thanks in large part to generous support from the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. We have a short piece on key issues in incorporating CTE into dual enrollment programs, which should be coming out in March. We'll determine the topics of the other two Gates-funded briefs as we monitor the issues that arise in dual enrollment in the states in the coming months. The State Data Elements Project is actually a partnership with students of Uri Treisman. Uri, as many of you know, is a policy rock star who heads up the Dana Center at the University of Texas, Austin. His policy students this semester are going to do a 50-state search of SEAs and higher education governing entities for dual enrollment participation and outcomes data. And so for the first time that I'm aware of, we'll have 50-state data on whether enrollments are reported by various student characteristics and which students are actually participating and succeeding in dual enrollment by state. And as you probably know, the U.S. Department of Education has surveyed high schools and post-secondary institutions for this data, but their published data do not allow you to make state-by-state comparisons. So I'm happy to answer any questions you may have about these products and services, either in our Q&A session or offline. Thank you so much.
Great, Jennifer. Thanks so much for your excellent presentation. And I wanted to pose a couple of questions that we're getting from our audience and remind folks that you can continue to type your questions and comments into the questions box for us to ask to the presenters. One question that was asked, which was really interesting, was whether or not you saw any trends related to funding of dual enrollment, and if you had any analysis or assessment about who pays for dual enrollment within the states.
Right. So in terms of whether the student or parent is on the hook for tuition, in 2008, we found 22 states had that model, and this dropped significantly to, I think, nine states somewhere in there. I'm pulling up a piece of paper I have on my desk, nine states in 2013. And the other models we saw in 2013 were 18 states in the District of Columbia made it a local decision, so it was agreed upon by the school district and the partnering post-secondary institution if it was going to be, for example, a split between the two entities, or if maybe a third partner, maybe a foundation or a business might help fill in tuition and fees costs, or if it was going to be primarily the responsibility of the student and parent to cover tuition. And then it really gets, it's disparate from there. So in 10 additional states, there were multiple programs in a state, and who was responsible for paying tuition varied by which program students were in. In four states, it was a state, so in other words, either the legislature or a state level agency had it written into their budget to cover tuition. And in four additional states, it was the school district's responsibility. In Michigan, it looked like it was a combination of the state, the district, and the student and parent, even though they have two different programs that seem to be a similar model in both programs. And in Utah, it's a combination of the state and the student and parent. And then in three states, there wasn't a real clear funding system put into place. It wasn't spelled out like in those other 18 states that it was entirely the local district and post-secondary institution setting an agreement, but it just wasn't specified at all.
Great, thanks. It sounds like there still is a real diversity, and it's nice to know that your database is a place where you can go and find that information. One of the trends that you did mention was about evaluation, and I think that's looking more specifically at program evaluation. But I'm wondering if you could talk about if states are beginning to encourage long-term evaluation of student success. Are states including, perhaps in their longitudinal database, information about how students do fare in college and or careers, if they are a dual enrollment participant?
Mm-hmm. We did see some states that incorporate this in their longitudinal data system. So for example, in Illinois, the state board, the community college board, and the board of higher ed include information on participation and performance in dual credit programs in their state-wide longitudinal data system. And I think this was also the case in Maryland, Vermont, Wyoming. I'm going to go back to Maryland in our database really fast because yes, so in Maryland, the governor's P20 council is charged with ensuring the college and career readiness and college completion strategies are implemented, and the council is required to report to the governor and the General Assembly on the progress of implementing specific strategies, including dual enrollment. But there are some states, sorry.
No, please go ahead.
There are some states, and I don't know if this is answering your question, that in their reporting requirements require that the data include how students are faring when they get into a post-secondary institution in the state in terms of placing into remedial ed or not, second-year persistence, sixth-year completion rates for students who are in baccalaureate programs. So looking at those data that early students are collecting will be tremendous to see how states are progressing when they participate in these programs.
That's great, and I think that's a lot of good information moving forward, and I know ECS will continue to be a resource for folks to continue to learn about what states are doing and what new trends are. I want to encourage folks to continue to type their questions into the box, and for folks whose questions did not get answered or asked for specific information, please know that we will follow up with you afterwards. I want to go ahead now and introduce our next speaker, Adam Lowe from the National Alliance of Concurrent Enrollment Partnerships. Adam.
Good afternoon. Thank you, Jennifer and Joe, for inviting me to participate today and for your continued work highlighting successful college and career readiness strategies such as dual and concurrent enrollment. I'd like to talk today about both state policy as well as institutional policy that address the quality of dual and concurrent enrollment coursework. Next slide, please. In reflecting on the issues confronting college and career readiness, I think it's valuable to step back in time to understand the history of dual and concurrent enrollment. This visually imposing example of Gothic architecture is Joliet Township High School. It is the birthplace of the public community college. Back in 1901, the University of Chicago and Joliet High School partnered to establish Joliet Junior College at a time when post-secondary education was reserved for the elite few. Only 2% of the college age population was enrolled in college. This innovation created an academic mirror of the first 2 years of coursework at the University of Chicago for students who wish to pursue a college education in their home community. This new model of higher education was critical to increase access to college for more students, in a symbolic way created the ultimate pathway for students to navigate the transition from high school to college. You merely had to walk up a flight of stairs. There are many parallels to today when you consider the remarkable growth and demographic shift in the student populations enrolled in both secondary and post-secondary education in the 21st century. Our history lesson next takes us to the University of Connecticut and St. Louis University in the 1950s, both of which established partnerships with local high schools to offer college courses at the high school campus. Dual and concurrent enrollment continued to emerge in isolated locations around the country throughout the 1970s, as well as through the 1980s, you started to see clusters of programs in pockets around the country. Notably, for our policy conversation here today, in the late 1980s and early 1990s, we began to see a few of these states, such as Minnesota, Utah, Virginia, and Arkansas, enacting statewide policies that encouraged more institutions to develop programs and start to address access so that students were able to enroll in these courses regardless of what part of the state they were in. The model really began to take off in most places in the mid-1990s, and in many instances in conjunction with the growth of tech prep programs that established career tech consortia. Next slide, please. During this period of rapid growth in the 1990s, the established programs sought each other out and began meeting in 1997. This resulted in the formal establishment of the National Alliance of Concurrent Enrollment Partnerships. Our national membership network now includes over 260 colleges and universities, dozens of high schools and school districts, and 13 state agencies. We support our national network of dual and concurrent enrollment professionals by sharing the latest knowledge about best practices, support research efforts, and engage in advocacy with media, state agencies, and the federal government. Our annual conference features 2 days of presentation on the latest innovations in the field, and we provide other opportunities for professional development through workshops, webinars, and a Washington policy seminar. Our membership is engaged in numerous committee work to facilitate dialogue and information sharing, including a state policy leadership committee. Next slide, please. Now, for those of you data junkies, the National Center for Education Statistics report that Jennifer mentioned earlier and is cited on this slide, and a companion study they did of post-secondary institutions, has rich data on the prevalence of dual enrollment nationwide. As you'll see, this non-traditional course location, which is most widespread, at the high school or secondary career center campus, warrants academic oversight from post-secondary institutions. Of the high schools offering dual enrollment on their campus, 89% have high school instructors deliver some or all of college courses. This is what NACEP defines as concurrent enrollment, a subset of dual enrollment, when a college-approved high school teacher teaches a college credit-bearing course to high school students. One of the concerns of the founders of NACEP in the late 1990s was the quality of the programs being created during this period of rapid expansion. Thus, they decided not only to create a membership organization, but also adopt a set of national standards and to begin a peer review accreditation process in 2004. There are now currently 89 programs nationwide accredited by NACEP, with 10 additional programs currently undergoing initial accreditation review this spring. While NACEP's primary focus is on concurrent enrollment and the accreditation process is restricted solely to that model, virtually all of our members offer multiple models of dual enrollment. Next slide, please. Upholding standards we have seen to be a vital factor in credit acceptance and transfer among colleges and universities, particularly in the area of dual and concurrent enrollment. Broadly speaking, concurrent enrollment is accepted widely and transfers well. Our accredited programs do follow-up surveys of student alumni, and most report transfer rates of over 90% or higher. This national study, conducted by WICHE a few years ago, looked at credit acceptance, both for required and elective credit. But national statistics mask the variation in acceptance. What we have seen is that it is imperative for concurrent enrollment providing institutions to demonstrate the academic integrity of their credits in order to gain the trust of credit receiving institutions. And this is one area that state policy comes in, and Jennifer highlights in her report, that 22 states now require public post-secondary institutions to accept dual enrollment credit in the same fashion as they would any other transcripted credit. In states without such policies, such as Michigan and Virginia, the flagship doctoral granting institutions often use the lack of quality or standards as an excuse to impose added restrictions. I will talk more about state policy related to quality standards in a little bit. Next slide, please. To understand NACEP's role as an accreditor, it's important to understand the quality assurance system used by higher education institutions in the United States. There are over 4,500 degree granting institutions of higher education, with a wide range of diverse missions differentiating their institution. Our higher education system is premised on a belief that institutions must have the primary responsibility for academic quality, Generally speaking, our state governments do not write or approve curricula, do not examine the credentials of faculty, or review the performance of students. The primary means by which colleges, universities, and programs monitor quality in the United States is third-party peer review accreditation carried out by private nonprofit organizations. Now, of these four types of higher education accrediting organizations, NACEP falls within the category of programmatic accreditors. In addition to NACEP, you'll find in this category other specialized and professional accreditors that accredit specific programs, professions, such as law, medicine. We accredit the program of concurrent enrollment offered by the institution of higher education. While our standards are prescriptive in a number of ways, they've also proven to be flexible enough to accommodate a wide range of institutional structures across the country. I don't have time to discuss all 17 of our accreditation standards in depth, but you can see that they're broadly covering four areas, that of curriculum, students, instructors, and program oversight. Curriculum includes areas such as syllabus, assessment methods, student expectations of learning, and course philosophy and pedagogy. Student standards address things such as registration and add and drop policies, course prerequisites, and grading scales. Instructor standards address the need for departments to only approve faculty if they would hire them to teach on campus, provide them with course-specific training prior to teaching a course, and annual discipline-specific training. Institutional oversight is critical to ensure that there is tracking of instructor participation, that faculty make site visits to high school locations, the program evaluation is conducted on a regular basis, and that transcripting occurs in generally accepted practices. Through our work, we've seen that institutional policy is critical to ensure the consistency of the academic program across all disciplines and partnerships engaged in by the university or college. Next slide, please. The Education Commission of the State's policy scan found that state policy provisions related to instructor or course quality for post-secondary providers of dual and concurrent enrollment exist in 37 states now. The standards vary across the states, but a common intent lies behind these standards, that college courses offered to high school students are of the same high quality and rigor as the courses offered to matriculated college students. As the only set of national standards of excellence for concurrent enrollment partnerships, NACEP standards serve as a model for statewide quality standards in 16 states. 9 of these states additionally require or encourage their colleges and universities to obtain NACEP accreditation formally in policy, while a handful other do so informally. In 2010, NACEP did a study on state oversight mechanisms. We found few states had the technical capacity or interest and institutional trust to approve or monitor compliance with the standards. One of the benefits of the third-party peer review approach is that you are engaging experienced institutions who have no vested interest in the outcome, thus respecting institutional autonomy and removing it from local politics between two-year and four-year institutions, and avoiding governmental audits of syllabus assessment and faculty. Few states are able to resist the urge to create compliance-driven review processes. One of the things that we've learned that overly prescriptive and regulatory structures often arise due to the actions of one or a few bad apples, thus upsetting the entire apple cart. That's the importance of all institutions upholding high standards. Next slide. There will always be those individuals who believe that college is college and high school is high school and that never the twain shall meet. If we are to achieve our goals for student transition and college completion, it is imperative for us to eliminate the artificial breaks in the continuum of knowledge acquisition. Dual and concurrent enrollment represents a proven low-cost scalable model so that students gain the exposure of the academic challenges of college while in their supportive high school environment. It creates a seamless system to work for students, but we need to continue to legitimize concurrent enrollment by demonstrating that it is possible to offer authentic college courses to high school students. With that, I'm happy to take any questions.
Thank you so much, Adam, for that great presentation and overview of our organization and the importance of accreditation as a mechanism to ensure quality. We've had lots of questions that come in, and I think folks in particular, and if you don't mind helping me out with this, are still struggling with terminology. So perhaps, if you don't mind, just reviewing again where concurrent enrollment falls in the broad umbrella of dual enrollment, I think that would be helpful for our audience right now.
My apologies, I muted myself. A study that was conducted by Indiana University found over 50 terms in use across the states. And so the terminology in this varies widely state to state and institution to institution. And Jennifer's database actually has a very good listing of all those terminologies. The way that Joe defined dual enrollment earlier on was something, I'm going to get the words not precisely right, but along the lines of any opportunity for a high school student to enroll in a college course and obtain college credit for that course. We refer to concurrent enrollment as a subset of dual enrollment, and it is the particular model where a high school teacher is credentialed by the college or university to deliver that course, typically in the high school setting. There are, of course, within all colleges and universities offer different opportunities for dual enrollment, and most offer multiple models, including opportunities for students to come on the college campus, students to take courses through distance education or online, and occasionally sending college faculty out to high school locations.
Fantastic. And so another question is, and perhaps you can answer this from thinking about your membership, is given that on average, or given that students in concurrent enrollment are taking courses in their high school, do you have information on where they're choosing to enroll post high school graduation? Are they enrolling in two-year colleges, four-year colleges, or transitioning directly into the workforce?
I would say all of the above, and some of the studies that Jennifer mentioned states are beginning to engage in with their longitudinal data systems are able to track that. So it really varies institution to institution. We have some small rural community colleges that those students almost all continue on to that same institution, whereas we have other universities and community colleges that serve students who tend to go on to a wide range of institutions, including elite private institutions or out-of-state institutions. So it really varies across the program, and that's one of the factors of program design that if you are implementing a program, you want to consider. Who are your students that you're targeting? Where are they going to continue on to post-secondary education? And what are the particular courses and resources that they need in order to successfully manage that transition?
Great. And given that concurrent enrollment can be offered in the high school, we can make the assumption that in partnership with an institution of higher education, any high school in the country can offer these courses. Can you give us a sense on average of what types of high schools are traditionally using the concurrent enrollment model? Is it urban, suburban, or rural, or a combination of all of them?
Sure. What we saw in the NCES data recently is that nearly 1,500 public high schools across the country, which is 4 out of every 5, are enrolling students in dual enrollment courses. We know that traditionally we've seen students, particularly in suburban locations, enrolling in these courses. But what we saw between the NCES's prior study in 2002 to the one that looked at school year 2010 was that higher growth rates were seen in schools that were in rural settings, as well as in the northeast and southeast regions of the country, as well as students with high percentages of students who are ethnic or racial minorities. So we're seeing growth throughout the country, but in particular pockets, we're seeing even more rapid growth. And I think that's partly related to the emphasis of policymakers on increasing access for low-income and other students who are underrepresented in higher education.
Fantastic. And I think that this is a perfect time to segue to our next set of presenters. We will be hearing about the efforts in Vermont to build flexible and personalized pathways for all students and using dual enrollment as a core strategy to achieve this goal. We'll be joined by John Fischer, Deputy Commissioner of the Agency of Education, as well as Joyce Judy, President of the Community College of Vermont. John?
Thank you. To begin with, I'd like to provide a quick situational perspective on Vermont. Here in Vermont, we have a history of educational innovation and creativity for years and years. And we place a high value on public education, which has resulted traditionally in a willingness to fund public education, pre-K-12 at a high level. That's not to say it's without conflict at times, but certainly now is a balance between tax rates and funding. But we do have a very high value placed on the educational system here. We have also over the years convened partners to study and deliberate high leverage policy approaches to effective learning opportunities. As recent as 2002, we had a commission that produced a document called High Schools on the Move. And this was a unique document in that it contained a compendium of things to do, things that we should do in education and in schools. Interestingly, it also contained a list of things that we should immediately stop doing in schools in order to move towards high quality and innovation. Some of these were implemented, but not at scale across the state, which we have struggled with for a few years with that at the implementation level. And we'll talk about that in a minute here. Later in 2009, the State Board of Education convened a policy commission who produced a detailed report titled Opportunity to Learn. Once again, this commission provided some great focus on things to do in our schools and to transform our schools. Once again, on the implementation side, full-scale implementation at a statewide level was unsuccessful until recently. So let's step back a minute for the Vermont context to give you some demographics. We have a declining student population over the last 12 years, and just recently this year dropped to about 80,000 public education students. We historically have reported a high graduation rate, one of the highest in the countries, yet we also report high rates of remediation when students transition to higher education after they graduate from high school. We have about 60% of our high school students that enroll in college within 16 months of their graduation from high school, yet not high enough for our goals. We would like to move that to approximately 80% participation rate as we go forward. Our achievement gaps in Vermont pretty well align with our poverty gaps, and likewise, these translate to opportunity gaps. So we have been addressing opportunity and access and equity for students with some high leverage policy movement. Years ago, we collaborated with other New England states in the development of assessments for No Child Left Behind. This set the stage for future partnerships across state lines here in New England. So our goals here in Vermont are to raise aspirations, increase college and career readiness academically, socially, and emotionally, prepare students so that when they finish high school, they end up with more options as opposed to fewer options. And we wanted to do so through development of strategies, embracing personalization of learning, and innovation and creativity around learning opportunities for all students. And we stress this many times throughout our policy and implementation work that these opportunities are for all students. At the New England level, as I mentioned, we have a history of collaborating with many of the New England states, and we found over the last 5 years a growing interest in many similar development strategies other than developing assessments for No Child Left Behind. This interest resulted in the formation of the New England Secondary Schools Consortium. There are five New England states, Maine, New Hampshire, Rhode Island, Connecticut, and Vermont, who have been approaching our goals of aspiration and participation rate and readiness together, providing a unique opportunity for policy development and sharing of resources and best practices across state lines. We approach all of these with a common theory of action. Our theory of action is perhaps unique. We believe we will be successful in a sustainable way only if policy, practice, and public will are addressed simultaneously. Historically, reform efforts, even in Vermont, have focused on either changing policy or practice. Few have focused on changing public perceptions. Without buy-in from educators in the public, schools may temporarily comply with rules, usually without implementing systemic change. At the same time, schools that have embraced personalization and innovation many times find themselves operating outside of the existing policies. This can at times be quite an uncomfortable situation and does not really provide a sustainable environment for public policymakers, educational leaders, and teachers, and certainly local school boards. We found, as a state collaborative across New England state lines, we needed to develop the political and public will required to sustain innovative change over the years. So we engaged across a number of the New England states. We engaged governor's staff, legislators, state board members, superintendents, principals, teachers, business leaders, and higher education to address the policy environment. As far as legislation, Act 77, our Flexible Pathways legislation of 2013, declared expectations and as importantly, permissive use of funds. We also declared that high school experiences should include elements of flexible pathways that were specifically placed in the legislation. All students should have access to internships and other work-based learning opportunities, career and technical education and pathways, virtual blended learning opportunities, and early access to college through dual enrollment and early college programs. As a matter of fact, in our history, speaking briefly about career technical education, our regional career tech ed centers were early adopters of dual enrollment 5 or 6 years ago and really jumped out in front of this. A significant policy for us was also determining and deciding in policy that public school funding could be used and was permissively used for college experiences. Previously, it was the practice and policy that those public education funds were limited to pre-K-12 experiences. Also, not insignificant in this legislation is the requirement for personal learning plans for all students beginning in grades 7 and 9 and moving forward each grade between 7 and 12. These personal learning plans will provide very clearly access and opportunities to students and plan out the access for all students as well as on-ramping students from a readiness perspective. Next, we addressed at the state board level, the State Board of Education rulemaking, our education quality standards in their final steps now to approval, creates a proficiency-based system to graduation where time is no longer the determinant of learning, but rather it is a variable to the requirement of demonstrated learning. Personal learning plans once again guide a student's set of experiences towards a readiness not only for graduation, but for post-secondary experience such as college or careers. Currently under development is a statewide community engagement and messaging project with a strong emphasis on the use of student voice in spreading the word and engaging the community in a sustainable way to implement this over the years. This will feature students and adults discussing and designing what personalized learning leading to college and career readiness will look like in the future. This will scale to a statewide dialogue over the next 3 years. At the bottom of this screen, you'll see a link to some recent resources that we developed through a task force, really digging deeper into our personal learning plan. These materials include essential elements of what Vermont's personal learning plans and processes will look like, and a self-assessment for schools guiding them to a readiness and full implementation of personal learning processes. I'd like to thank you for the opportunity to discuss these developments in Vermont, and at this point I would like to pass the program to Joyce Judy, the president of the Community College of Vermont. She's been a driving force in the early years here of dual enrollment and a key collaborator in the recent advances of Vermont's pre-K-16 landscape. Thank you. Joyce?
Thank you, John. And first slide, please. Next slide. So before I talk specifically about dual enrollment, I just want to give you a quick overview of the Community College of Vermont. We are the second largest college in the state. We're unique in Vermont in that we only have one community college in Vermont. And at the Community College of Vermont, we have 12 different locations, and you see that on your screen. So it's with, we say that we're within 25 miles of 95% of our population. So we have 12 locations. We have a robust online program, and we enroll 7,000 students a semester. And that doesn't seem like a lot, probably from some of you, but we are a rural state. We have a total population of about 620,000 people. We currently in Vermont offer dual enrollment programs, concurrent enrollment, and also an early college program. Next. So at the Community College of Vermont, we have been doing some form of dual enrollment for the past 10 years. And we see dual enrollment as playing a significant role in addressing both economic and some demographic issues that we face in Vermont. So if you look at the economic side, no matter what data you look at, either the fastest growing jobs or the majority of jobs that will exist in 2020 all require education beyond the post-secondary level. Secondly, if you look at associate degree holders, and this is in Vermont, and I'm sure it plays out across the country, that people with an associate degree earn 36% more than those with just a high school diploma. And probably even more important in tough economic times, unemployment rates for associate degree holders in Vermont are 2 points lower than other folks. While college isn't a guarantee for a job, it opens many doors and creates many more opportunities than without a college education. Next slide. In addition to that, in thinking about dual enrollment and some of the important things around demographics, as John referred to, Vermont has a very high high school graduation rate, and yet we have one of the lowest college-going rates in the country. So there's some disconnect between high school and college. And at CCV, our focus for dual enrollment for the past several years has been what I refer to as shrinking the age gap. Our current age, our current average age is 28. And we often see students coming to us 10 years out of high school having spent 10 years in dead-end, low-paying jobs. And we started thinking about dual enrollment as a way to help particularly the students, the middle majority of students, have a successful college experience while they're still in high school so that they could imagine that they might be successful in college. Rather than waiting 10 years, maybe they would think about college after a couple years being out. And wouldn't that be a gift to them, also a gift to the Vermont economy in providing, we hear so much from employers, we need workers with stronger skills. So we have always seen dual enrollment as a way to sort of help plant seeds for students who are still in high school. We also believe that dual enrollment helps us to improve college readiness. We all know the data nationally and in Vermont is students who enter college needing remediation, students are just much less successful. And then the two that are often very common associated with dual enrollment is how, you know, one, it's a good strategy for reducing college debt and also shortening time to graduation and a college degree. So dual enrollment plays an important role in our thinking in Vermont, both from an economic and a demographic perspective. Next. So when we think about of offering a dual enrollment program, I would say there are lots of challenges, and today I want to focus on three and offer up some strategies. The first one is around access. How do we make sure all students have access? When we offer a dual enrollment course on a college campus, how do we make sure that students who don't have transportation, for example, are able to get there? Students who for whatever reason, social, academic need some assistance to be able to access college courses. The second is quality and rigor. How do you make sure you guarantee that the courses that you're offering, whether it's on a college campus or in a high school, are of the same quality and rigor that all of your college courses are? And then resources. Dual enrollment programs don't happen without a commitment of resources. Next slide. So I want to offer up a few strategies that we have used in Vermont, and they have really helped to helped us to move forward. The first is, in terms of thinking about access, probably the most important strategy around creating access for students is to build a strong collaboration with our K-12 partners. I believe so much that this is about collaboration and not about competition for students. I do hear horror stories from time to time outside of Vermont about how dual enrollment programs are about creaming, taking the best students. No longer can they offer high-level courses. They're all being offered by colleges. What I would rather focus on is how do we work with our K-12 partners to make sure that we are increasing high school graduation rates and college aspiration rates for all students. And that has served us incredibly well. I'll give a quick example. We have a high school in the northern part of our state who, when we first went to talk with them, they had a lot of resistance to dual enrollment and the whole idea of their kids taking college courses and what would that do to their school. And we worked really closely with them in trying to figure out what courses we could offer, how we could work with them to achieve their same goals. This is a school that has 342 students, 9 through 12. 53% of them are on free and reduced lunch. It's a very rural school. And I'm proud to say that this semester, 20% of their junior and senior class students are enrolled in a dual enrollment course. It's been a few years in the making, but I think if you went to that school today, they would tell you that this has been a great partnership. But it takes time and a willingness to sit down and talk and develop some common goals. The second strategy we've developed around access has been a course that we've called Introduction to College Studies, which really targets younger students. This year we've been targeting 10th grade students and an occasional junior and senior level student. But this is an on-ramp to dual enrollment. For many students, going from high school to taking a college course, we found was too big a leap. We were seeing students not be successful in dual enrollment. So we have been working with a number of philanthropists and also with Vermont Student Assistance Corporation's Gear Up program in developing a course called Introduction to College Studies. It's not a dual enrollment course because we do not give college credit for it. Many high schools give high school credit for it. But it really introduces students to the language of college. It talks about credit. We also model and use strategies that they will find in a typical college course. It has been a huge success in increasing the success rate of high school students taking dual enrollment courses. Another quick example on this program, we were working with another very rural school who they were not participating in either Introduction to College Studies or dual enrollment. We sat and met with some teachers and guidance counselors, and they said, here are the reasons why students are not participating. One, they don't have transportation. Two, many of them are from poor families, and these are courses that are offered after school. They need to work instead of taking courses. And they don't have the discretionary funds for textbooks. So we worked with that school and worked with a local philanthropist. And now we offer busing for students. We provide meal vouchers so the students can get a meal before they go to take that course. We are providing them with scholarships for all their textbooks. And probably most important, if they successfully complete this course, we are giving them a stipend that would have covered the cost, how much they would have earned if they'd been out working during the hours of that course. We have doubled the enrollment of students participating in in Introduction to College Studies and dual enrollment with this course. But it's a partnership between the school, philanthropists, and the Community College of Vermont. Next slide, please. As has been mentioned earlier in with a couple of the other presenters, one of the things with dual enrollment or concurrent enrollment, paying attention to quality and rigor has been something that we have tried to keep on the front burner. At CCV, if we offer a course in a high school taught by a high school faculty member, we hire the faculty member. They must meet the same, they must have the same credentials and meet the same expectations that all of our faculty do. We offer professional development for high school teachers who are teaching college courses. We also, we have standard course objectives for all of our courses, whether they're taught on at CCV locations or in a high school. We expect anyone teaching a CCV course to teach those objectives. And no matter where a faculty person is teaching, we do evaluate faculty and we ask them to go through the same kind of evaluation that we do for all of our students. So whatever, wherever we're offering a dual enrollment course, we treat that the same as we treat any of our courses. We don't want our dual enrollment courses to feel less than a college course, because then we believe we haven't done a service to our students, because we want them to be able to use their dual enrollment credits when they transfer and go on to whatever college they choose to go on to. Next slide. And finally, around resource strategies, a couple things I've mentioned. It has been critical for us in Vermont and at the Community College of Vermont to build relationships with philanthropic partners. These are people who do believe that providing opportunities, particularly for students for whom they don't imagine going on to college or colleges in their future. This is something we've really been able to get some partners to support. We've also reached out to different grant providers. For example, we have a grant right now with the Nellie Mae Educational Foundation. They have been a key partner in helping us to develop some marketing materials and do a marketing campaign, particularly for students for whom this wouldn't come naturally. And third, I think that we can't do this alone. We need to collaborate with community partners and organizations, such as the Department of Labor, and local businesses have been key to our work. Next slide, please. And finally, in closing, I think the things that that have been important to us in building our dual enrollment program, one is relationships. It's relationships, relationships, relationships. It is key for us in terms of, we're a small state. We need to have a lot of partners, particularly the K-12 folks. Staffing has been critical. At the Community College of Vermont, this can't be an add-on. We need to make sure that we provide the staffing that can build these relationships, because they are key. Paying attention to quality and rigor is essential. And finally, I would just throw in the branding. Branding is vital. The branding has to appeal to an audience, and in this case, it's often 14 to 17, 18-year-olds. It is different marketing material than we would use to our general CCV audience. And you'll see some examples of some of the branding that we've done and some of the marketing materials that we've produced. We actually did this over a period of a few months with focus groups with 14 to 18-year-olds, and it was very helpful. But again, it's not marketing to our traditional college-age students, it's to a younger audience. So with that, I'd like to thank you and for the opportunity to share what we're doing in Vermont.
John and Joyce, thank you for a really excellent presentation and an overview of the comprehensive work that's been going on in Vermont. We've had lots of questions come in, both for the two of you as well as our whole panel, and I encourage the audience to continue to type your questions in. John, I'd like to start with you. Your comment about your career and technical education training centers being early adopters of dual enrollment sparked lots of interest and curiosity.
Can you talk a little bit more about what that looked like, and in particular, what types of credits students were earning through, what types of post-secondary credits students were earning in those partnerships?
Well, and I'll ask Joyce to chime in here, because that's what we partnered with Joyce on at the community college, as well as our technical college, Vermont Technical College. They offered their pre-existing college courses on site at our secondary ed CTE centers. So those students were receiving college credit for those courses only when the student's instructor was had applied for and had been certified by the colleges. So it was in Adam's term, it was concurrent enrollment. And from Joyce's perspective, I think it was instructors that she had endorsed and certified as college professors.
I would also say that one of the things, I think it's been one of the best educational innovation movements in Vermont. When we started running dual enrollment courses in, or concurrent enrollment courses in technical centers, because students had to, we used the ACCUPLACER assessment, and students had to demonstrate that they had college level skills to enroll in those courses. And when we first started, not very many students could meet those assessments. But as we developed the program, that became a carrot for students. They wanted to earn dual enrollment credits. And so we worked really hard with technical centers to help them, help students develop the academic skills they needed so that then they could access dual enrollment credits through their technical courses.
Great, thanks. And there's also been some questions that I'm hoping both of you can clarify this around instructors. Joyce, you mentioned that CCB is instrumental in hiring the faculty. Can you talk about how you hire or select faculty for the concurrent enrollment courses, the ones offered in the high school or in these secondary technical centers?
If a high school teacher is interested in teaching a course for us, they get in contact with us. So that's one way. Another way is if we're working with the high school, like say we're working with the principal or the guidance counselor, and we decide, okay, they would like us to offer this course at the high school. They may have a recommendation to us that we have a very good high school teacher that would be interested, and they put us to get in touch with each other. So it can happen a number of ways, but in the end, they need to be in touch with us. We need to hire them. If they're teaching during the day, they get a $0 contract from us. So it's not, we have to be very careful in Vermont. They can't double dip. They can't be teaching on their day contract and also getting paid by us. But we do issue them a $0 contract so that there are things very clear in our contract that they must meet.
Great. And so one final question for the two of you, and then we'll open it up to our panel as a whole. Folks were very struck by the comprehensive approach that the state collaboration across the P20 or P16 spectrum has taken in terms of building these pathways. Given that you mentioned that you had currently a low college going rate, have you begun to see an uptake in college going in the state of Vermont, or how have you felt like these comprehensive approaches are starting to play out in terms of outcomes for students?
I think Joyce has some statistics in terms of some of the intro to college studies students. We have seen probably a 2 or 3 point increase over the course of dual enrollment up to, I would say, the passage of Act 77. This year, although it's fairly recent, since Act 77 expanded dual enrollment through greater funding and really a exposure to a branding and access point as well. Last year, for instance, before Act 77, we had about a 6% participation rate of juniors and seniors in high school in dual enrollment, and this year early on with early reports in from fall and anticipated January enrollments, We're seeing over 10% participation rate of juniors and seniors in dual enrollment. And while we expected that, we didn't think it would come that quick. We expected probably a year or so into Act 77, we were hoping to reach a 10% participation rate. And then in the future, we will track that on a longitudinal system to see what that translates to ongoing. Joyce, do you have a...
Yeah, and in addition to that, I would say that one of the things that we have been doing, having some longitudinal data with Introduction to College Studies, so for the past 5 years, we now are seeing students who have enrolled in Introduction to College Studies, which is targeted at a high-risk population. 65% of them are first generation. Many are on free and reduced lunch. 20 points higher for students who are going on, who go to college than the state average. So it is a significant strategy, and we are feeling quite positive about that strategy. And we will start collecting that same kind of longitudinal data with dual enrollment. But Vermont as a whole has been doing that, but CCD in particular around Introduction to College Studies has looked at this and feels it's very rewarding to see those kind of results.
That's great, and thank you so much for sharing. And I want to let our audience know, many of which are asking specific implementation questions to the programs that you've described in Vermont, that we will be sure to connect you with both John and Joyce afterwards so that you can follow up and get some of your specific questions answered. But at this point, I would like to open it up to the entire panel, and I want to start with an overarching question that everyone has talked about a little bit, and perhaps folks can reflect on the trends that they're seeing, but everyone has begun to talk about that dual enrollment in all its forms is becoming more a strategy available to more students, that this isn't necessarily just about the highest achieving students. I'm hoping that perhaps we can go through the panel as a whole and folks can talk a little bit about what they're seeing either from the research perspective or from practice about who's been benefiting from dual enrollment and how this increased access has, what have been the drivers for increased access. Jennifer, do you want to take the question first?
Sure. What was interesting, and it was a data point that we didn't include in the database, was as I was going through the policies last year, we were seeing more instances than I remember seeing in 2008 where when states had, and I should add that states, many states significantly revised their dual enrollment policies, so it wasn't so much an update as wiping the slate clean in a lot of states and starting from scratch, but when states were significantly overhauling their state policies over the last 5 years, in many instances, there was a statement of legislative intent or something to that effect saying, we want dual enrollment to be a strategy to broaden access to post-secondary education and better improve the preparation for the workforce and these sorts of things that we weren't seeing so much of 5 years ago. So I think that was really significant that policymakers are understanding that dual enrollment could be a meaningful strategy to improve college readiness and college going, particularly among traditionally underrepresented students in higher education. And it could be that this is coming back to some of the research we've seen coming out in the last 5 years from CCRC and others demonstrating that all other things being equal, low-income students of color are more likely to enter college and complete a degree if they do have dual enrollment credits on their transcript.
Thanks. Adam, do you want to respond? Adam, I think you might still
be
on mute.
Sorry about that. Yeah, I'm here now. Yeah, indeed, as Jennifer mentioned, the research is starting to show, in addition, the research is starting to show that low-income students and other underrepresented students are more likely to benefit from dual enrollment. So while the benefits certainly are valuable for all students, students who are first in their family to go to college and low-income students are going to benefit even greater from dual enrollment programs. And so I think we're seeing an emphasis on that both among policymakers and among institutions.
Thanks. John, would you like to take this question?
Just from the perspective of our approach here, which was underlying all of the legislative discussions and state board discussions, was a particular focus on a group of students that may not be at some point in their public education aspiring to college and changing those aspirations and opinions as an on-ramp to then addressing the readiness. I think that's been our approach to dual enrollment and pretty successful so far.
Joyce, can you also take that question and also share with us if you've seen from students that have participated in dual enrollment with your institutions, if it indeed has shortened their time to degree decrease the amount of time it's taken them to perhaps transfer to a four-year institution?
I would say that I think that if we only hit the high flyers or people who are going on to college anyway, that I would be really disappointed and feel like Vermont, we have not been successful. So from an institutional perspective, you know, back in my presentation, the whole idea of how do we shrink the gap, how do we plant some seeds for students that we might see 10 or 15 years later? How do we help them realize that they could be successful in college and perhaps think about college earlier on? So, and we are seeing the success of that, and it's very encouraging. I think the piece that, I didn't mention, and I would say this, that dual enrollment is not about recruiting students to your institution. Dual enrollment is about opening up and creating opportunities for students. And for me, that is incredibly important. We know that if we do a good job with dual enrollment, some of those students will come to the Community College of Vermont, but it's more important that they think about going to college. And so we are seeing people take dual enrollment credits in-state, out-of-state, elite, publics, whatever. And that is incredibly important. But I think for us, from a CCV perspective, where we want to commit institutional resources really is how do we make sure that this program, that the middle majority of students who could oftentimes most benefit by a dual enrollment experience know about it and have access to it. So I think that creating, focused on first generation students, people who are low income, those are just incredibly important populations for us to focus on, not at the expense of people at the higher end, but they're equally important.
Great, and that actually leads me to another question, which perhaps is related. I think the way that you framed dual enrollment is really around perhaps an indicator of college and career readiness. If students are able to participate in these courses, we know we're providing them not only with the academic content of a college-level courses, but some of these additional skills that they need to be successful in college. John, is Vermont using participation in dual enrollment as an indicator for college and career readiness for accountability purposes? And then perhaps, Jennifer, can you talk about trends that you're seeing on that across all 50 states?
Interesting question, and relates back to, I would say, Vermont's heritage and history of innovation and creativity. At the same time, we don't tend to go with the national flow on a lot of things, and accountability is one of those. We would prefer to look at indicators and outcomes. We would rather not plan our education quality and future on leading indicators because they tend to mislead. But certainly dual enrollment as a measure of readiness, as long as it's not a high-stake measure of readiness that turns into blaming and sanctioning schools, we tend to turn that to these are our expectations for Vermont students, these are the opportunities available to them, and if we see schools that have access issues, we want to go and support those access issues, whether that's in career development or career counseling, and deal with access, but we don't tend to take those indicators as accountability from a larger picture.
Thanks. And Jennifer, can you talk about that perhaps from the national perspective?
Sure. So as I mentioned earlier, in December last year, ECS launched not only the dual enrollment database, but another database that looked at across the 50 states what indicators are being measured for school and district accountability, and we identified 9 states where dual enrollment was a factor. And this was separate from many other college readiness factors that we found in states such as ACT or SAT participation or scores, some sort of broader, generalized college readiness piece. And then a separate indicator was what actually gets reported, what is printed on a school or a district accountability report card that's put on the district website, the parents receive in the mail, this sort of thing. And in this case, we saw 8 states that included dual enrollment as one of those metrics. And what's interesting, actually, is that of those 9 states that use it for school grading and the 8 states that use it in their public reporting, there's only overlap between 3 states on those 2, Minnesota, New Mexico, and Ohio. And the others, in the other 5 states, it was measured, it was part of the school grading system, but it was not in the public report card. So that was just kind of an interesting twist. And then just as an aside, we will be having I haven't been involved with this project, but I do know that we have a policy brief coming out based on the data from the database later this month, I believe, so people can get a perspective on what's happening nationally and things that are positive or perhaps not so positive in terms of reporting and school grading.
Great. Thanks so much for sharing.
This is an area that there's been a lot of growth in lately. Yeah, this is an area there's been a lot of growth in lately. I haven't done a 50-state survey on it, but going back about 3 or 4 years, I had only identified about 3 or 4 states that were incorporating dual enrollment into their accountability systems, and a handful more that were incorporating them into the report card systems, as Jennifer's mentioned, slightly different. But indeed, with the advent of the ESEA waivers provided by the Department of Education, there are 9 states, and it's probably the same 9 that Jennifer's identified, that have now actually been approved to utilize college and career readiness indicators, including dual enrollment, for high school accountability systems. And they tend to do this both on student participation as well as student success, so the percentage of students actually earning a passing grade in the course. There's an additional 2 states that have federal waivers approved but don't use them in their annual measurable objectives, but do include them in sort of reward school categories. So this is an area that, and I hear from more and more states that are considering this, and certainly more and more that are including it in report cards. I think it's an area we're going to continue to see growth in state policy in this area.
Great, thanks. And questions have been continuing to come in, and I know we're getting close to the end of our time, so I want to remind the audience that for questions that were unanswered today, we will either follow up with you directly and connect you with one of our presenters. In addition to posting some of the questions as a blog post on the CCRS Center's Ready for Success blog. So we've had lots of questions about, we've had lots of discussion about access issues, and in particular there's been a question about ability for students with disabilities to participate in dual enrollment opportunities. And Adam, I'm wondering if you can talk a little bit from your membership, and then perhaps John and Joyce, you can address that from Vermont's perspective.
Sure, and I don't have any good numbers on this, but what I would say is that it's a particular challenge, but an important one for school districts and post-secondary institutions to overcome. And so what we have seen is that it takes some diligent planning in order to align the K-12 requirements for students with disabilities with that of the post-secondary requirements for students with disabilities, and then make sure that information sharing is happening across the 2 systems. So there are a few programs out there that have some specific programs to encourage students with disabilities to move straight into post-secondary education, particularly students who are having difficulty following a traditional academic pathway and are more better served by a vocational pathway. And at least 1 statewide initiative in Massachusetts that has really focused on supporting students as they engage in post-secondary coursework.
Thanks. John and Joyce, in Vermont, how are students with disabilities participating in these opportunities?
They are participating certainly, and that is our access and equity approach here. similar to all students, the goal here is to back up the planning and on-ramping for students, and that includes students with disabilities as well. To prepare for that transition planning for students with disabilities earlier and earlier so that we, like any student, we don't find ourselves sitting here 2 months from graduation saying, oh, I wish I could have been prepared for this or I wish I had known about that. So the whole approach that we've taken is for all students, and that includes students with disabilities, for on-ramping and readiness so that we can have all students ready. But recognizing that in college it is different. We don't have IDEA requirements in post-secondary, so that becomes part of the readiness mix.
Thanks. And Joyce, is there something that you wanted to add?
No, I would support what John said. I think it is. We have a lot of students with disabilities at the Community College of Vermont, not unlike most community colleges. What I think is really important about dual enrollment programs is helping students understand what it's like to be in college, what are the expectations. And for students with disabilities, it's also understanding the difference between your K-12 education and what happens when you go to college. And so being able to help with that transition and make that transition successful. So I think it is important that students with disabilities see this as an opportunity. But I also think at the same time, just like with all students, it's how do we help make sure that the transition from high school to college happens as successfully as possible.
Great, thank you. And I do know that there's been many more questions, and as I mentioned, we will follow up with folks. But a lot of the questions have dealt with these issues of coordination and collaboration, and I wanted to give Joe Harris from the College and Career Readiness and Success Center an opportunity to talk about a recent publication that CCRS put out, particularly around coordination and collaboration. Joe, can you share a description with that?
Sure. Thanks, Jennifer. As Joyce and John and others have mentioned, one of the key keys to success in dual enrollment programs is the collaboration and conversations between K-12 folks and higher ed folks. So I wanted to call people's attention to a new publication that came out in December called Considerations for Collaborations to Support College and Career Readiness, a Facilitator's Guide. And this guide looks at 8 key questions around the topic areas of the purpose of the collaboration, participants in the collaborative effort, and the implementation and accountability for collaborative efforts. So this is available on our website, and not only does it include these questions and key considerations, but a pretty strong research base in the appendix that supports the use of these different questions in a facilitated conversation. Again, you can see it at our center at ccrscenter.org and invite people to use it and give us some feedback.
So thanks, Joe, and I want to thank you as well as all of today's webinar presenters. You can see their contact information here as well as the web addresses for the CCRS Center and AYPF. Both the slides from today's webinar as well as a recording will be posted on both of our websites in the coming days. In addition, we'll be following up with folks for the unanswered questions today. I hope you enjoyed this presentation and hope that you'll tune in for our next webinar soon. Thanks so much.